Welcome back. Let's get right into the mailbag for today. Taylor writes in with two related questions. That is, perennial flowers and ornamental grasses are growing like crazy, and they're just crowding each other out. He wants to know if it's better to transplant them in the fall, or even now, or just wait until spring. And he also wants to know, can you split the ornamental grasses? Well, first, great question about transplanting. It can be kind of a game of roulette around here to transplant in the summer. When temps are hot and water gets at all scarce, it can be just disastrous for any transplanted plants. It's considered best practices to hold off on transplanting until the fall, so at the very least, I'd consider waiting a few more weeks to get to that yard task. Transplanting in very late summer or early fall has the added benefit of a plant getting used to its new home for hopefully many, many weeks before the first frost. Ornamental grasses are easy to divide into smaller parts and will replant as well, as long as you get a good chunk of roots in as well. And in fact, it's a good idea to do that somewhat regularly with ornamental grasses. They tend to expand and then often get a dead spot in the center, so dividing them up can keep that from happening. Stacy messaged me on Instagram about her hydrangeas and wondered, why aren't they blooming? She says she didn't prune them and they're not in the shaded locations, both of which could inhibit blooming. And she says her neighbors are getting blooms on their hydrangeas. Well, one possible solution could be to try a slow-release granular fertilizer that's high in phosphate. That could be the trick. They're often marketed as a bloom boosters, but in checking the three numbers on the fertilizer that denote the three chemical components of nitrogen, phosphate, and potassium, that first number should be low and the middle and last number should be higher. So for a bloom booster, the number sequence should be like 3, 4, 5 would be a common one you'd see in your local garden store. Good luck with those blooms. Marlene writes in wanting some help from critters eating her red tomatoes, specifically the birds and squirrels. She has a raised garden bed, but also a mesh fence around the garden, which keeps out the rabbits, but it's doing nothing to inhibit the birds or the squirrels. Now, a cloche like this one here could work over many plants, including tomatoes. The covering can sometimes lengthen the growing season too and provide some insulation from colder temperatures in the fall. Now, a row cover, it's just like this concept on steroids. It's made of similar material, just goes over a much larger area. It's actually easier to cover a larger area than a single plant. Optimally, it has to be staked down to keep the squirrels from getting at your tomatoes. Draping it over your garden fencing could keep it out both the birds and the squirrels. Deterrence, a good way to keep away the snacky squirrels and birds. Hanging objects like a shiny mobile of old CD or reflective tape like here can deter birds, but they won't really work with squirrels. So would a fake owl or a scarecrow. Motion detector sprinklers could startle squirrels and birds, but if they're really hungry, they'd probably ignore both and just forego the sogginess to have a snack. Distractions also could be a good route to go in your yard. Tomatoes high in water content and ripen at the warmest and sometimes driest part of the year. Putting up a bird bath or a squirrel or bird feeder away from your garden could give the backyard invaders something else to set their mouths on in the yard. If you've got any gardening questions, feel free to email me here at the station, tjoyce@wgntv.com. Make sure to tell me where you live, and pictures of your problem plants can also be a big help too.